Hocam sesiniz gelmiyor ama.
Okay, guys. Today, I am going to talk about functions and algorithms. The following topics will be studied today. Concept of an algorithm, representation of algorithms, algorithm discoveries and problem solving, iterations, recursion, and algorithm efficiency. What defines a good algorithm? What defines a bad algorithm? How do we solve problems in general? And I'm going to introduce a function concept in C programming language as well. I will continue function topic tomorrow. So tomorrow's class will be continuation of remaining parts starting from today. So, an algorithm is an ordered set of unambiguous executable steps that defines a terminating process. That means we will know what to do. We will be able to define what to do. And it has to have an end. It has to be executable. It has to be executable by someone, some computer or some person. And at the end, it has to have a termination definition. If it doesn't terminate, it is also possible for certain applications. For example, you have a grocery store, you are trying to make money, you keep selling products until, well, continuously, but the general algorithm is you do that until you die. So everything has an end, but some algorithms may have iterations, continuous loops, but that is beyond the scope of this definition. So it has to have an end. It has to finish, beginning and end. Algorithms require well-defined primitives. Well-defined means unambiguous. Ambiguity is not tolerated. Ambiguity should not be present. So if I say A is equal to B in the algorithm, so value of B is assigned to A. So it's for sure. There is no discussion. There is no discussion about it. It has to be clear. We call them well-defined primitives. And generally, a programming language is a collection of primitives, those primitives. When we write primitives one after another, it becomes a program. It solves a certain problem. Why do we program? The reason we do programming is to solve existing life problems. So life has its own problems. So humankind tackles those problems with solutions. Those solutions require steps to implement. If we collect those steps on paper or on file, that becomes an algorithm. And if it can be well defined, clearly understood and clearly written, then it becomes a well-defined algorithm. Solutions like reduced inflation cannot be an algorithm because steps are not clear. What to do is not well-defined. So in order to have an algorithm definition, contents must be well-defined, unambiguous. In the previous years, in another university, I was giving a microprocessor course, and we were requiring students to draw their flowcharts for the algorithm, explain their algorithm, explain their program. So it was like 10 points out of the question, 30% of the question mark was given from the flowchart. Picture of the algorithm. And in order to get the credit, just one of the students did begin, solve the problem, and actually I was asking the algorithm of the solution, but what he did was begin, sort the numbers, and so it wasn't telling me anything. He did zero grades from that because it was ambiguous. I couldn't tell whether he was able to do that box clearly. So he didn't get any mark. Therefore, if you are defining something as an algorithm, you need to explain it in unambiguous ways so that a person who is reading it can implement it one by one without big differences. One famous example from the book and many other books is Japanese origami algorithms. So they have famous origami figures that can be made from the simple piece of paper. Very different, nice looking objects. The benefit of having those objects is questionable. They are all only good. Unless you are making a paper plate or something, paper cup, something useful, generally they look nice and they are artwork. But to generate the artwork, you need to fold paper in certain way. The steps can be implemented, the steps can be written down to anybody so that if you follow that steps, you end up with the resulting figure. So first fold, turn around, fold again. So different ways of folding. Pulling, folding are implemented one after another. At the end, you will end up with the origami figure. This is an algorithm for the origami figure, the bird. So how am I going to represent this origami language? This origami language can be defined with certain symbols. For example, one symbol, that's syntax, one symbol may mean that turn paper over like this, the other side. Shade one side of paper, distinguishes between this side and that side. So it is like equality test for the other side. Back, meaning back. Fold, folding the paper. The other side. Fold over. This becomes folded. push. So certain syntax symbols correspond to certain operations that will make the language of algorithm in any domain. It could be cooking, it could be origami, it could be studying, it could be programming, it could be social interactions, algorithms. For example, there is an algorithm of going to student registrar's office. You go there and you give your student ID. They ask you, what is your problem? And you explain the problem. You expect an answer. So that is the algorithm of a student going to student registrar's office. Again, it has to be unambiguous. In order to define an unambiguous algorithm to a problem, what is the first requirement? What is the first requirement? To understand the problem, you have to know the algorithm. You have to understand the problem so that you can suggest an algorithm. That algorithm may not be correct, but still an algorithm. Algorithm may fail, or algorithm may not end up with a desired result. You may not get the desired result, or algorithm may be correct, but not that much. So it may not be precise enough sometimes. It is good enough, so sometimes it is not good enough, but it is still an algorithm. So algorithm may be wrong. That results from the poor understanding of the problem. Assuming that you are in a physics exam, why do you make mistakes? Usually, you make mistakes because you didn't understand the problem well. If you understand the problem well, you don't make mistakes unless there is a multiplication error or typos. In order to prevent that, what do you have to do? You have to write clearly in your exam papers. If you solve your problems clearly, if you write clearly, then it is less likely that you will make a typographical error or calculation error. Most student errors in exams or in homeworks result from either from not understanding the problem correctly, second, not writing very well on the paper or on the computer screen. So if your code is not well written, clearly written code, then probably you will make a mistake. Therefore, I will ask you to write clearly, use paper properly, and get additional papers if required in all exams, because certain percent of the errors are attributed to bad handwriting. You understand? Okay, thank you. Similarly, you may understood the algorithm. You are writing down the algorithm, but since your handwriting or text editor writing in programming environment is so bad, indentations, variable names, it is so bad, no comments in the program. So even you cannot understand what you are writing, and then you will make mistakes. You may make algorithmic mistakes because you look at it, it looks correct. Since you didn't write it clearly, the indentations, while loops, etc., you don't understand, you don't comprehend, pictorially comprehend the problem. It show it. It is something else that you have in your mind. Then your algorithm won't work as you expect. It will work some way, but it will not provide the result that you want. Therefore, be careful. For example, typical conditional algorithm may have something like this. If there is a raining, if it is not raining, and if temperature is equal to hot, go swimming. If the temperature is not hot, but raining is not true, then play golf. If it is raining, hit the bottom, watch television. So this is a kind of algorithm that determines a person's decisions. Daily life algorithm. Yeah. İçinde değil, yanlış koymuş. Şurada şey olacak. There's a curly brace there. Yoktu da ben koydum. Normalde tek satır diye olması gerekmiyor ya. Okay. This will not compile, so it will make an error. So this is a student MACT algorithm. That's from the internet. T-making algorithm. Begin, get the teapot, ocağı yak, su kaynadı mı, çayı demle, çaydanlığa su ilave, tekrar ocağa koy, kaynadı mı, demlendi mi, bardaklara koy, servis et, then finish. So this is çay yap algorithm. Tea making algorithm. Has 15 steps. Each operation should be unambiguous enough. What is unambiguous enough? So adding water to teapot may be a complex task if you are in space shuttle. You will go to water machine and plug the teapot, etc. So there will be very extensive work in some situations. But at home, it is like, okay, no problem. It's understandable. So each step must be unambiguous to the parties involved in the algorithm. For example, this is also has some deep details if you want. Which stove, at what temperature, how big is the stove, is where is the stove, do we have a stove, is it working, is gas is connected. So there is a whole interesting algorithm within that step four. Therefore, if it is unambiguous enough, we accept it, but keep in mind that it also has some other sub steps sometimes. So this is the tea making algorithm, same thing. So there in the algorithm there are some checkings. Checkings are done by these shapes. And the steps are indicated by rectangles. Begin and end is indicated by round rectangles. So if I ask you to write down chai yap algorithm, begin, Şey yap. And is this an algorithm? No, because it is not explaining çay yap business. It's not explaining it. So it's a flowchart, but it doesn't explain anything. However, if our context of operation is like operation of student registrar office, and in the operation of student registrar office, get the guests, make tea, no one is interested in how to make tea. Making tea is unambiguous in another context. In the office environment, when you say make tea, other party understands how to make tea. They don't ask questions because how to make tea is not important. Making tea is important there. Therefore, this may be a box if you are talking about a different, bigger problem. If you are talking about welcoming visitors, then çay yap, çaydanlık, ocak, waiting, those are not important if you are dealing with guests, visitors. Only making tea is important in that case. Therefore, çay yap becomes sub-operation, a separate operation by itself. You understand? Yeah. Değilsin. Şundan, öğrenci işlerindeki ziyaretçileri ağırlama sürecinde çaydanlığa ne kadar su koyduğunun kimsenin umurunda değil. Senin orada anlatmak istediğin ziyaretçi öğrencileri, işte Erasmus'tan gelen öğrencileri nasıl karşılayacağınla ilgili bir şey anlatmaya çalışıyorsun şeye, sisteme, kişiye. Mış olman lazım. Evet, o kişinin çay yapmayı bilmesi lazım. O kişi elbette hiç hayatında çay görmemiş bir adama çay yaptığın zaman hı diyecek, olmayacak. Onun bir kere yapmış olması lazım. Dersteyim şu anda ama kim arıyordu? Tamam. Acilse cevaplarım. Tamam. Bye bye. Therefore, the detail of, for example, we have been adding two numbers in microprocessors in the simple assembly language. That is your lab assignment, for example, lab session. You know how to write assembly code. You know how to add two numbers. But if I say A equals to B plus C in the program, is it necessary to understand the assembly language? Is it necessary to explain how it is done in assembly? No. I am not interested in that part at this level. So it is at different levels. For example, a director might say, there are students coming from Erasmus in from France. Get them in and welcome them. That is the only word. How am I going to welcome them? That's a different thing. If he says welcome them, probably he knows, he assumes there are certain things, the campus tour, tea, drink, lunch, etc. So certain things will be in the algorithm of welcoming. But a general welcoming might also be used within another context. Or president appoints our rector as a rector. As he approves our rector as a rector, is president going to tell how to welcome Erasmus students? No. But probably it is in the duties of the being a rector in a university, welcoming people, organizing meetings, assigning tasks to faculties, etc. So those are subtasks of being a rector. Okay? Perform as rector and becomes a function. A big, bigger, upper level function. Okay. So in a student house, I try to find a student house tea maker here. Usually dirty. Study, make tea, drink tea, study, eat, make tea, drink tea, sleep. So this is your daily routine. You don't do anything else. Here, there are two make teas. Okay, and studies. Therefore, if you know how to make tea, I don't have to repeat. I don't have to repeat all the 15 steps. Here it says 15 steps. But I am not interested at that level. I am interested in student daily life. Furthermore, tea making is the same. It repeats. So if I write this in a separate place, if I know it, my main algorithm becomes simpler and more understandable. And this will be, when you are making tea for the second time, the same code. It becomes the code in the computer. Same code can be executed without writing another code. You don't have to write separate make tea again for the second tea making. What you do is use the first tea making algorithm because they will be the same. You don't have to write the same algorithm twice. Is that clear? Therefore, a function definition, a function concept is invented with the function definition. We define a function, a certain name. We define a function. Once we define a function with 15 steps, I can use it later. For example, a process loan, giving money, process loan function can be defined, and then it can be used within the program, just like welcome students or make tea. If something goes on, if students arrive, make tea. So make tea is defined somewhere else. You probably understand this is good enough. Maybe I extend this too much, but this is important to. It is important for you to understand what an algorithm is and how detailed it should be. It has to contain detail that you want. It doesn't have to contain all the details all the time. It should contain details that you need for that type of business, for that type of activity. If you are interested in tea making itself, because you are interested in making good tea, you are a tea drinker, you are very interested, so tell your friend that put the water after you heat the tea in dry. So you change the algorithm so that you will make a better tea. In that case, you are interested in tea making algorithm. But here, you are not. It is fixed. So tea making is just used as a regular routine task. Right. An example in C programming language. Multiplication is usually can be done like this. But what if we didn't have it? What if we didn't have it? Let's do it in functional way. So first you declare that there is a multiplication thing going on. Declaration is not available in some languages. In some languages, declaration is not required. Actually, in C, you may get away with it. You may get away with it if you define, this is definition. If you define the function before using it, it is usually not necessary in most languages. It is usually not necessary to declare it before. But in most languages, in C2, in this cases, you are going to use multiply as a function, T making. When the compiler sees this multiply, the compilers will say, what is this? There is a word, it could be Ahmet IJ. Okay. There is a word that I don't understand. What is this? Is it a keyword? No. So, quit. I didn't understand. So normally what happens is that. But since you declared it at the beginning, int multiply ab, compiler first learns that there will be a function. There might be a function in coming lines that has a name given as multiply. It will accept two numbers and it will return an integer. So that it learns something is going to come like that. Something is may going to come. May or may not going to come later in the program. So that's why we need to declare it before using it. In some other languages, scan all the files, grab whatever is available. They make tables automatically and use that table first, generate that table first, then start compilation. That's also another second technique. So declaration is not strongly followed in some languages. Can be done without declaration, but generally these are declarative languages. Yes. Why do we use it? Because it is going to return a value. We say that I am the boss. We say that it is going to return a value as integer. So the result will be an integer. I could have say float, then it will be a floating point number. I could have said void, then it will mean it is not going to return anything. So I declare it, but did I define it? Not yet. But at this point, my pick. At this point, my compiler knows that multiply is not a bad word. Multiply is a word that will correspond to a function. So it will start generating tables, start translating it to assembly language. When it says multiply, the compiler will say, where is the multiply? There was a function, but where is it? So it looks for whatever is available. Then multiply is defined later in the program, or it might be in another file in the same project. So it doesn't have to be in the same file even. It can be in another file in the same project. But declaration is there. So after declaration, compiler keeps that multiply is okay. Someone is going to tell me that multiply is working. So it will reach there, multiply int A, int B. So it is actually a multiplication definition. What it does is it returns A times B. It's a silly function, but If you can print hello world, I am multiplying, something like that. So then wherever you call multiply ij, the function at the bottom part will be called, just like the t-making algorithm. If you want to multiply again, you do it again. How do you multiply two matrices? Üçe üçlük daha kolay. Do you remember this? How many of you remember? Did you learn? Be honest. Did you learn these in high school? So you are innocent. So what you do is writing this makes it a little bit hard. Let me give you a very interesting trick. You write it like this. This is the result. This is the second. The top right is the second. Top, this is the first one. This is the second one. This is the result. So these are the elements. What you do is this one, view very carefully. This one and this one is multiplied plus this one and this one is multiplied plus this one and this one is multiplied is equal to this one. Then this one and this one, no, this one and this one multiplied plus the second one and the second one from the top plus third one and third one is equal to written here. So all rows and columns, that makes an operation. Ij, aij plus aij times bij and blah blah blah and some formula. So if you are going to have two matrices rather than integers, matrix I, matrix J as a data structure. Okay, so if you can have a function multiplying those matrix values, within that function, all these multiplications will be done and return value will be matrix. So whenever you want to multiply two matrices, it will automatically multiply matrix, because matrix multiplication is not ambiguous. Not ambiguous. So just save all steps to function. So wherever you need multiplication of two matrices, call the function. Don't do it manually. Do it manually in the function. But if you are in the student registrar's office and welcoming students, don't go to kitchen. Just ask for somebody to bring tea. Okay. Everywhere. Good question. Let's see. You may have linear or nonlinear problems, including derivatives, partial derivatives. You may have production problems for the industry. You may have banking problems. You may have correlation problems. You may have problems in robotics, for example. A robot arm is going to take some equipment from here to here. So all the angles of the robot arm is written in the matrix columns and rows. So this position is given in columns and rows. So the trajectory that you follow, what are the paths from this point to this point, is calculated using matrices. There is no other way. So matrices are not only for mathematics, it's for real life. Most cases, we don't realize it. For linear equation solving, for example, use certain some of you have shoe sizes of 42, some of you have shoe sizes of 43, some of them 44. So you may have a relation and you are trying to find why do some people have 44 and 43. So you are trying to find the relation. Then you need matrix operations and inversion, etc. So electrical circuits also, you need matrices to calculate currents in the circuit. In the high school, you probably know that there is a lamp here, there is a battery, there is a battery. You know these kind of problems. There is a switch, etc. Right? But what if you have two lamps? Both of them works. But say this is 2 ohms, this is 4 ohms. What are the current? This is 5 volts. Right? So 2 ohms, 4 ohms, 5 volts. What's going to happen? So these are all solved by matrix operations. Why do we have? I already explained this to a certain degree. Certain part of the code is repeated, like tea making. For example, this is swap. There is a sub program somewhere in the code. So sub program is called again and again and again. Therefore, I can write it somewhere else. So whenever I need, I move the transfer to microprocessor. This is very important. Since you are now able to understand assembly language, you know the meaning of functions very well. Because in order for a program to function, to work, you need an assembly code. You understand that. You need an assembly code. And assembly code works by incrementing program counter, right? Program counter follows. So here program counter follows, but somewhere your program counter jumps to another place. Another part of the memory is executed, then you go back to original place. So it is kind, there is a jumping going on from one memory location to another memory location. So that jumped part of the memory location contains chayap algorithm, swap algorithm, whatever algorithm you like. So in your regular program, jump to that part, finish, go back. How do you remember where to go, where to come back? Program counter is incremented, jump. How do you go, come back? You need to save where you go to some place. We call it as stack pointer. So stack pointer shows the last element in that place. So you have to have a register, special register, at least. That special register contains the return address once you jump. So before you jump, you save the next address of the program counter, next instruction, to that register. Jump, execute, execute, execute, execute, execute, because it is like regular program. At the end, there is a special instruction called return. Return instruction checks that special register, okay, checks that special register, restores the program counter, and you, your program continues. If the jump also has parameters A and B, like memory locations, how am I going to notify function? How am I going to send A and B to function? Because function doesn't know A and B. There are multiple ways. One way is to let them in registers, put them in registers, and that function, Chayap algorithm, knows that whenever I am called, he is here, sugar is here. So both calling manager and T guy knows that where the tea and sugar is, or how many glasses are required. I say chai yap, 5. Garson, 5 chai. So 5 information must be sent to chai yap function. Where is that? You need some paper to give it to the tea guy. That is another location in memory. That 5 is written to that part, and the function is jumped. Again, that is the stack we call, stack space. So we put the number into stack, call the function, and the function T maker looks at the stack, okay, 5, then makes 5T and returns. In that case, 5 chai is return. If the return value is integer, return value is also put into a stack, replaced, that 5 is replaced with the T, and then caller will pick up the T from that part. So stack is used to communicate between main program and functions. Is that clear? If a function calls another function, it ite it kuyruğuna kuyurur diye bir atasözü var. Is it possible? Yes, a function can call another function. So we said return address will be saved in a special register. So when you have return, you go back. But if the function calls another function, what happens to the first return address? It was full. And if you write something on it, previous value will be lost. That means we cannot use single register for that. If we use single register for that, our architecture will only support one level of functions. We cannot jump to two level of functions in that kind of computer architecture. So therefore, what people do is they have stack data structure, we will see that, can accept multiple things, and you use stack as multiple papers. You put something on the stack, you put another thing on the stack, so the thing that you put last stays on top. When you want to get it, you get the one on top, and it goes down by one, so next one will be the previous one. With this approach, you may have multiple functions calling each other more than one time, and still remember where to come back. İyi bakıyorsunuz, fena değil, anlamış görünüyorsunuz. Öyle mi? Tabii buyurun. Evet, evet. İlk koyduğu en altta dönüş adresi var. Ondan sonra da sayılar var. Gidiyor çaycı, şekeri alıyor. Şekeri alınca şekerin olduğu yer boşalıyor. Çayı alıyor, o da boşalıyor. Yapıyor, koyuyor. Dönüş adresine de geri dönüyor. Yani hepsinin yerleri belli mutabakat içerisinde. Dönmez. So this is an example compiled code of certain same A plus B function. This is the main program. Main program uses call to call the function. And it says move A 100, move B 400. This is a very simple way without using stack. This is without stack. Add 20. At call 20. Call 20 means set the program counter to 20. At 20, it has push A, push B. What is that? Move A, move B. Add A and B. Out. Accumulator. Pop accumulator. Pop B, pop A. Pop means get those numbers back. Push means put numbers in the stack. Another important thing is these are little bigger details. When you jump to a function, normally my example is a tea making person. And the student register manager in the office telling that team make tea for the incoming French students. But in computer, there is only one CPU. So Levent Kırca has a very good episode with the Metin Serez, they were in a hospital, okay? And in the hospital, there was only one working person, who was Metin Serezli. Metin Serezli was both hemşire, both doctor, and security guard, and some other hasta bakıcı thing. So there are four or five people that Metin Serezli were imitating. So person visiting hospital from the Ministry of Health first enters the hospital and security guard welcomes it, hoş geldiniz, etc. And he said, bizim doktorumuz bir denedir. Indicating that he is a very good guy also. As soon as the visitor moves in, he runs from the back, changing the attire and imitating the doctor again, and welcomes the same person at the upper stairs as a doctor. So in the computer, tea making person and the student registrar's person are the same people because you have only single CPU. So you have to change your shirts from security guard to doctor to nurse, one after another. You have to change. Therefore, you need to store existing shirts, ties, whatever you have, in certain place. That is also stack. Therefore, These are saving and restoring operations of the function before starting. Function will save everything in the CPU to stack before starting, because it is going to use them and it is going to destroy the existing content. So when you come back, you have to come back as if nothing has happened. So as if nothing has happened is provided by remembering things even if you don't use it. Therefore, functions should save existing content of the CPU to somewhere in the call time, so that when you come back, it is not destroyed. That is usually happens between switching between main program and the function. Contents of the registers are saved. If it's going to be used. If it is not going to be used, for example, register D, for example, there might be a register named D. Since the function is not using register D, you don't have to save register D because you are not making it dirty. But if you are using it, make sure that you leave it as you have taken it. Therefore, stack is used. The concept of stack will be studied later in this course. And also in third year. Okay, let's give a break. Push puts something to stack. Pop retrieves from the stack. Think of it as a gun magazine, and you have bullets. When you push the bullet, you insert another bullet into magazine. When you pop the bullet, you take the bullet out. So it is like a bullet magazine of guns.
End of the file ile ne kadar şey yapıyoruz ya, karakter olarak kullanıyoruz. Ctrl Z end of the file ile ne oluyor? Backslash sıfırı nasıl şey yapıyorum? İşlersen. Teknik içinde backslash sıfır yapsam. İnternetten baktım.
O her zaman onun anlamı her yerde aynı değil.
Aynı değil.
Backslash sıfır. Backslash sıfır. Null. Null.
Çok şey yapamadım.
Ya. Yazıyla null diyeceksin.
Yazıyla null.
Yazıyla null da yazılıyor. N-U-L ile. O da keyword. Ya da backslash sıfır.
Şey, yani blockchain adresler var ya.
Ne?
Blockchain şifreleme adresi.
Evet.
O adresler nasıl takip ediliyor? Şey, yaptığı işlemler takip ediliyor ya.
Evet.
Nasıl takip edebiliyor musunuz?
Hangi parayı kullanıyorsan, o paranın
kesini kurmak gerekiyor.
Hayır. Orada şeyin transaction history diye çözebiliyorsun. O oradan yapıştırıyorsun o adresi. O daha önce kimden gelmiş? O ne kadar kimden gelmiş? İlk yaratıldığı mining'e kadar gidebiliyorsun.
Ha, aynen. O sitesine gitmek
gerekiyor. Evet. Yani mesela Ethereum'sa, elinde bir Ethereum cüzdan şeyi varsa, para miktarı varsa, o transaction'ın historisini geri giderek bakabiliyorsun. Ha. Ama kim olduğunu bilemiyorsun. Sadece evet, cüzdan numarasını görüyorsun. Numarası. Ben baktım da ondan hatırlıyorum yani. Öyle bakabiliyorsun. Yaratılışına kadar gidiyorsun. Hatta hangi şeyin cüzdanın yarattığını biliyorsun. Dolayısıyla hani Çin'de mi bilmem de mi belki bulunabilir.
Geçen benim cüzdan şey olmuş da böyle 12 kelime yanlış bir site yazdım. O da birine gitti. Adam da benim şeyin fakirleri çekip almış.
Ne kadar? Çok mu?
Çok değil de. Ha. Ama işte sadece adres takip etmek istedim. Nereye gittim?
Adresi bulabilirsin ama bir anlamı yok.
Bir şey yapalım mı?
Evet. Anladınız mı? Çok mu abarttım? Yani stack konusu, assembly konusu bu üçüncü sınıf konusu aslında. Ama şimdi fonksiyon diyorum, çay yapa git diyorum. Şimdi Levent Kırca'nın şeyi çok güzeldir. Onu bir ara size paylaşırım şeyden. Bakanlıktan müfettiş geliyor. Metin Selezli kapıda. Güvenlik hemen şapkayı giyiyor. Ceket işte hoş geldiniz efendim bilmem ne falan. Sesini değiştiriyor. Ondan sonra adam içeri yürüyor. Hemen bir çıkartıyor üstüne koşuyor falan. Hastalık izi tekrar üstünü değiştiriyor. İşte portakal koyuyor göğüslerine şey oluyor. Bayan hemşire oluyor falan. İşte hoş geldiniz saç peruk takıyor hemen. Ondan sonra tekrar koşuyor yukarıya muayene eden doktor pozisyonuna geçiyor falan. Sonra en sonunda tabii İsfiraz niye falan işte bakanlık personel vermiyormuş da hem güvenlik hem hemşire hem şey. Şimdi bu da öyle. Yani algoritmayı kullanıyorsun ama oraya giden o başkası değil. Aynısı yapıyor. Dolayısıyla üstündeki elbiseleri bir yere koyacaksın ki geri geldiğinde o elbiseleri tak diye giyebilirsin. Yani o mesela. Çok işlemcili olsa o zaman başka olaylar var. Diyelim 4 kişiyi taklit ediyorsun. 2 kişisin. O zaman işte ikisinin ayrı stackleri olacak. Ayrı memory space'leri olacak falan. İkisi 2'yi, ikisi 2'yi yapacak. Öyle. İşte 8 tane doktor var birinde. Personel var. Öbüründe 4 personel var.
Hocam, bir şey sorabilir miyim?
Hocam sesiniz gelmiyor.
So it's possible to ignore how job is done, knowing what is done is sufficient. If you are okay with the content, then function is a good solution to encapsulate a particular job, because you may use it later. You are not interested in details. You are satisfied with the details. You are satisfied with the details. You are not interested in details. So make it a function. C makes use, that's will be used. C makes use of functions easy, convenient, and efficient. We will often see a short function defined and called only once, just because it clarifies some piece of code. This is also interesting. We say T making can be called multiple times, so that we can make it as a function. But sometimes in C, a function is called only one. So why am I doing it as a function? Because it makes our code clearer. It makes our algorithm easy to understand, easy to analyze, easy to write. For example, you have an algorithm, and at some point it requires reading some information from some external resource. Make it as a function, because your main algorithm is about calculation. That external reading is dealing with other parameters that your main algorithm is not interested in that much. Therefore, separate that concern, separate that part into a function so that even if it is called once, that will stay as separate. Or it may be developed by your friend. You are writing the same program by job division into two people. One of you are writing main program, one of you are writing this function. So function is quite important maybe. So it takes quite a lot of effort. So that function is written by another person. Main program is written by another person, or multiple functions are written by different people, so that you will have job distribution. And at each step, you will agree that you will say your friend that you are going to write a multiply function. It's going to return the result, and I am going to send it as I and J, two numbers, to your function. If you agree with your friend writes multiply at the bottom, and you don't care. You just use multiply.
Main is a function.
Main is also a function. Yes, because it is usually void. If it is int, we use. It is usually regarded as an error code of the application. If you return zero, then that means no error. If you return some number, you will return an error code, so system can check. Or that's also used for the functions. If the function doesn't have to return anything, you can select returning error code if there is any. So the structure will be if tmake sugar Ceylan printf What is this? Very interesting. If T make sugar Ceylan, printf cannot make tea. T make returns an integer. If T make is successful, return zero. That means T is made. If there is something going on in T make int. This is definition of the tmake. Int şeker, int çay. These names doesn't have to be the same. You can use different names within the main program and within the function definition. They correspond to same variable, but variable names can be different. Is that clear? So şeker, çay, whatever. If something goes wrong, for example, ocak is not equal to one. If ocak is not available, right? If ocak is not available, error code is equal to seven. Seven means ocak is not found, right? And at the end, return. Error code. Okay, so this will return error code 7 if ocak is not found. If everything goes well, that's a long code. If everything goes well, T will be made and error code will be 0. Yes. Because I said because it is int, huh? Olur, pislik olur o zaman. Yani efendi programcılık olmaz. Ve bir hafta çalışır, ikinci hafta bir şeyler daha eklemeye kalktığında ya bu başka şey dönüyordu falan, ne oldu abi falan gibi yerlere doğru gider.
Error code sıfır dışında her şey olabilir değil mi? Rastgele yazdım.
Tabii tabii, ya rastgele yazdım. Ocak
yedi. Exit'in burada olayım.
Program quit ediyor artık.
Break döngü kısıtı
exit. Exit komple gidiyor. C programından çıkıyor şeyle.
Tamamen hiçbir şey kullanmamış gibi mi? Hiçbir şey okumamış gibi mi yapıyor?
Evet. Ha, hayır şey, shell'e çıkıyor. Program quit ediyor. Hatta bu, bunun içine de koyabilirsin. O kodu verecek.
Print'i yapıyor mu?
Ha?
Print'i yapıyor mu?
Yapar. Önce onu yapar. Ondan sonra. Hani bazı komutlar çalıştırılamaz mesaj çıkarır ya. Onlar öyledir. Veya program çalıştırırsın hata verir. Bilmem ne hata diye. Bu şekilde.
Sonrasının önemi yok yani.
Sonra. Nereden sonra?
İften sonrasının bir önemi yok.
Exit'ten yok tabii. Exit'te bitiyor program. Quit yani. Mesela o da yani öyle öyle olacak diye bir şey yok. Orada benim söylediğim şu. If tmake sugar Ceylan diye yapmışım. Bunu if diyorum ya. Acaba doğru mu diye bakmak için adamın bunu yapması lazım. Dolayısıyla yapmış oluyorsun da aynı zamanda. Hem check ediyorsun hem yapıyorsun. Check ettiğin ne? Abi bu çalışıyor mu? Bazı programlarda böyle güvenilir çalışması işte diyelim ki şey için neydi yarışmanın adı? Bayraktar'ın yarışması. T3 Vakfı'nın Teknofest. Teknofest'e gidiyorsunuz, roket yapıyorsunuz, bilmem ne yapıyorsunuz. Her attığınız adımda böyle if'ler yazmanız lazım. Bu çalıştı mı? Bu modül çalıştı mı? Bu böyle oldu mu? Bu şöyle oldu mu? Olmadığında ne yapacağını altına yazacaksın. Belki başka bir şey yapacaksın. Orada çay yapamıyorum, şunu ister misiniz falan da diyebilirsin yani. Tamam mı? İşte rokettesin işte, şunu ateşleyemedin, bunu ne yapamadın? B planlarının sürekli devrede olması lazım. O yüzden return kodları, returnler fonksiyonundan eğer return etmen bir şey gerekmiyorsa, hani bir sayıyı toplamayıp da sonucunu dönme olayı yoksa, böyle durumlarda yani iş şeylerinde, mesela roketleri ateşle veya kanadı bilmem 30 derece döndür diyorsun. Kanadı 30 derece döndürün, return'ı sıfırsa döndürdüm anlamına gelir. 1 ise motor bozuk, 2 ise bilmem ne şöyle. Şöyle ona göre tekrar şey alabilirsin. Başka şeylere karar verebilirsin ana programda. Bu çalışmadı. Ben bu sefer ne yapacağım? Öleceğim. Ölecek halim yok. Ona göre davranacağım diyebilirsin yani. Öyle kullanılır.
Exit parantezli.
Parantezli zaten.
Yok, içi kullanılır.
Kullanılır evet. Hata kodu. Ana şeye çıkartır onu. Ama konsola çıkartır. Onu başka bir programda kullanabilir sonra. Bir program kullanıyorsa oradan ne hata dönüyor diye bakar. Çağırdın bir şeyi. Ondan olmadı. Ondan 7 geldi. Ha ondan 7 geldi. Demek ki ben şöyle yapayım diye de programlar kendi aralarında şey yapabilir. Organize olabilir. O yüzden void yerine int daha iyidir. Ne yapacağım void? Yani hiçbir şey dönemiyorsan sıfırdan yani. Functions are of different types. Some functions are library functions provided by the operating system, provided by the language. So we call them as library functions. Those functions, like a printf, for example, is a function. Printf is defined in declaration header file stdio.h. stdio.h. Last time I had shown the contents of stdio.h to you. So those predefined functions allow you to work easier. Is this a function? No. That's the language construct keyword. Is this a function? Yes. Sign is a function in maths.h. When you include math.h in addition to stdio.h, you will have trigonometric functions, logarithms, etc. all available as functions, so you can use it. When you have string.h, you will have string functions automatically included so that you can use it. Standard C library functions.
Can we use it in exam?
In
exam.
What's that?
Quiz lesson.
It won't be necessary. In exam, in exams, your task will be writing something that you can write in the on the paper. Also, something that we can read and understand for grading. Some of you give answers in the exams. You work in the paper during the exam. But at the end, or you cheat. AF, B0, D7, A8, 006, 05, C3, C0, 00, 05, A7. So you give something like this. So what I want is an assembly code, assembly program. But the students write this to me and expects me to read this and grade it. I can't. I am not a computer. Therefore, please don't give this as the exam answer in your exams. Write the assembly code so that we can understand it. We are also human. Evet. Load'un karşılığını az AF diye bilmem ne diye yazıp da benim onu anlamamı beklemeniz komik. Orada not alamıyorsunuz. Yani o, anlamıyorum çünkü. Gerekiyor. Böyle sallanarak ezberleyeceksin. Daha çok. 10 tane kod var zaten ya.
Load 1, load 2 falan nasıl ya?
Yazarken load yazıyor. Load 1'in kaça karşılık geldiğini öğrenmenize gerek yok.
Ben sınavdan bahsediyorum. Sadece load yazacağız ama birim ikimi kastettiğimizden.
Yanına koyduğun şeyden.
Can mesela nasıl bir soru çıkabilir?
So, also there are in if we are talking about Windows environment, there are DLL files, dynamic library files. So those functions are loaded to memory whenever they are needed, because in order for a function to work, the first requirement is it must be in computer memory. But since we have too many functions, for example, printer function for Canon XJ something printer is in the computer, but is it in the memory? No. But it is in the computer, in the hard drive, the library is available. So if I connect a Canon inkjet printer, I can print. Is it in the memory? My word processor calls the print function. It is not in the memory. So what happens is, it is in the DLL files, dynamically load libraries files. So if I call the function, operating system, it says there is a function. Let me check it from DLLs. There is DLL. So it loads the function into memory, then starts that function. Dynamic library function. And the functions you write, on the right, we have the functions you write as the project, as the company, in the development of user programs. There are user defined functions. So later in Java language, name of the function C++, in C++ also becomes methods. So function is a general term. In some languages, it is called as subroutines. Some languages has subfunctions, subroutines, subfunctions, functions, methods. Okay. I don't recall anything else, but the function is understandable by anybody. For object-oriented geek discussions, when you use functions, they don't like you, so you have to use the term methods instead. But the same thing. Generally same thing. It is connected to an object, for example. There can be two teammate algorithms for husband and wife. Husband make the tea differently than wife. So if you treat a person, call someone, make tea, and you didn't pay attention to the gender, what happens? Each person has his or her own teammate algorithm encapsulated in the object, because it's an object-oriented language. Each object knows how to make tea by his or her standards. If she is wife, probably tea will be better, right? Or not, maybe other way around. So, but the algorithm can be different. The object-oriented approach says make a tea, and object knows how to make a tea by itself. And each object implement that function differently. And we call that functions as methods of the objects. Okay. Yes. Each object has different functions. With the same name, maybe, but a different name. Polymorphism. In C, more details. These are the parameter list to be shared to the function. This is a function definition. Parameters. This is the return type. It is going to return. So this will be integer. I create an integer in the function. It is like camping. When you go to camp, you set up certain place, you dig holes, you make a place for the fire, etc. You arrange the environment according to your camping needs. And when you go, you clean up everything, nothing remains. So C is like that. It is only for camping. It is like camping toilet. It is there while you are there. When you exit, C doesn't exist anymore. What exists is the return value. So C is assigned to return value, and as you exit, C is erased. So in the other part of the program, C is not available. Any questions? Because I am telling a lot of things here. Yeah. At this point, it will not compile. You will get an error. Yeah. Actually, for this simple program, you can return A plus B. That's a solution, but I am not interested in adding here. I am trying to show the local variable concept. So you create variables. Those variables are only there for that time. So for example, if this is 5 and this is 6, when you call the function, what is C? 11, right? When you come back, for example, print C. You have a print C at the beginning. But if you call the function first time, what do you print? Zero. If you call the function second time, what do you print? Zero. It does not remember. It does not remember. If you want them to remember, you put static here. If you define static int C, it remembers. In that case, it will print 11. However, it will consume a little bit more memory because that part of the memory will be preserved throughout your application is running. The other way, everything campsite, everything is erased from the camp as you leave the camp area. Any questions? This is it. I think I have explained everything. Without using, we don't have pointers here. No. Assuming that you are trying to return two numbers, like a complex number, I and J, you can return a pointer to an array. You can return pointer to an array. You can return pointer to a data structure, pointer to a struct. Or in modern object-oriented C++ or Java languages, we can return pointer to, can return an object. TMake algorithm can return T as an object. And T knows how to get, T knows how to show itself on the table. If it is Ceylon T, if it is big T, it can show itself differently. If it is small T, it can show itself differently. So T object is returned, and T object also has additional capabilities as functions, as methods built into it. So T can actually has some intelligence in object-oriented approach. So return value doesn't have to be integer or float or character all the time. In C programming language, the solution is done through pointers to arrays and pointers to structures. But an extended version of that is pointers to classes and classes as a whole. I think after this, I will stop. For example, sort. Today and tomorrow, we are going to talk on algorithms. Sort the list. Sorting is interesting. How do you sort? If you have two numbers, how do you sort those numbers from small to big? Check there is an equality. If A is less than B, print A, then B. If it is not less than B, if A is not less than B, then don't print it. Print the other way around. You sort two numbers based on this. How about multiples? You need a loop to check all the pairs. If the order is not correct, you replace the order. That is called as bubble sort algorithm. You check first, then check once more, check once more, check n times. Because at the end, there might be a smallest number. That smallest number will be replaced with the next one at the first run, with the next one at the second run, with the next one at the second run, next one at the second run. So after n runs, it will move at the beginning. Just like bubbles going up in the water, because they are the lightest one. That's why we call it as bubble sort algorithm. So we will be talking about sorting algorithms tomorrow, and also algorithm continue with the algorithm complexity. So now, if you have any questions, please ask also the people at home. Otherwise, we will have 5 minutes break and continue with the other lecture. Okay, thank you.
Hocam, bir şey sorabilir miyim? Hocam.